Hi, folks. We're going to finish out our week on Jacob, and we're just going to do a little bit of review.
Yeah.
And hit some of the highlights that we've been covering. And the first thing we really talked about with Jacob at this point was crises, how he had lived his life in such a way that it brought him to this final crises point.
Yeah.
But he's had crises after crises.
Yes. Yeah. And we kind of talked about how crises, it never leaves you in the same place, right?
Right.
How we handle it is what's going to determine, are we moving further in God's dream for us, or are we moving further away from it? But it won't leave us where we were.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that we learn about his type of crises is this is self-created.
Absolutely. Yes. It is absolutely self-created, which is, you know, frustrating to read his story. But if we really take an honest look at our own lives, that's true for all of us, right?
Yes.
And we can allow God to use it. We can allow God to change us through it. But it's usually something we've brought on ourselves.
Absolutely. One way or another, either it's been brought on by your actions towards others or whatever, or your response to others.
Absolutely.
Sometimes we only think, I'm innocent if I was wronged.
Right.
But no, actually your response,
you're still choosing.
You can blow yourself up as much with your response as you can if you were the initiator.
Yeah. I think actually for me, I can think of times right off the bat where I've totally taken that on myself, but it's easy to take on that this was done to me, not an ownership of how you've responded. Yeah, absolutely.
Which is where we blow ourselves up again in resentment and bitterness and unforgiveness grip our hearts, or, you know, it's enduring pain. We're in it way too long. And it's, you know, we waste life. We waste time. We waste energy. We waste our gifts all because of what, you know, our response too. So don't think of it just as your, what, you know, what you do to others, what Jacob did to others.
Mm-hmm.
But think about your response as others act like Jacob towards you.
I think we can look at any crises in our life, or at any time we're in crises, and really look at, how am I responding? How am I reflecting God's character in this? Where do I want this to move me to, so I can get out of my own feelings and start incorporating God's will into this?
And the next thing that came out in this wrestling match, kind of in this, It is. This comes first and this, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, you got these crises moments, and now he's in this one big crisis. He saw showing up with 400 mounted men the next day. And now we end into the next, which is God tests us.
Yes.
And so now he's up against the wall. This is when it's all hitting the fan, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all coming. And God wants to test something about him.
Absolutely. And I think oftentimes when we're facing these tests, and we had talked about this when we were studying earlier in the week, is like that night before, right? You don't get much sleep. You are going through the motions, whatever that is. If you're a Christian, hopefully you're turning to God and wrestling it out with him, working it out. But when God is testing you, there's something in you that needs to be worked out. He doesn't test you when you're completely humble and surrendered, and he's doing his work through you, and it's just a nice flow. He's testing you when there's something in you that's gotta let loose or gotta go.
And what he was testing with Jacob at this particular moment was, how badly do you really want my leadership here, Jacob? Are you really willing to turn it all over here? Because here's the phrase we're basing this on. Then the man said to me, let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And so they wrestled all night long to get to the point where it's dawn, new day's beginning.
Yeah.
And Jacob has to make a final decision. And he's saying, no, I'm hanging on. I'm sorry. I'm not going back into me for this day ahead. It is you, God, I need.
Right.
And I'm not going ahead without that blessing.
Yes.
He was tested deeply, and he passed this test.
Which is amazing. I mean, they wrestled all night, and we had spoken quite a bit about how God could have taken him out in an instant. But that, like, this is a process. This crisis is a process. The testing is a process. There was a process he had to go through in that night. God could have done that, but he didn't until the morning, where he struck him at the hip, took out his strength. And then, he didn't let go. He knew, I'm not going a step further without God's blessing. What a place of surrender to finally get to.
Yes. And let's not underplay what played out just in the hours before. Pain.
Yes.
Wrestling all night.
Yeah. Exhausting.
It's a painful and tiring thing. He'll be exhausted, emotionally spent. His body's going to be aching like crazy. and still he won't let go. Mm-hmm. But you see, that's crises. Mm-hmm. And he, in the crises, and no matter what crises you go into, there's always going to be these points where the pain and the tiredness feels like it's just going to overwhelm you. It's those, those moments, just say, I'm not letting go, God, because I want your blessing.
Yeah.
And don't pull back. Just hang on.
Yeah.
Just hang on. Next, we go from test. And now we step into something about, you know, his name.
Yeah.
And I admit.
I'll admit.
Where he really, God's answer to his thing, I'm not letting go until you bless me. And then he says, what is your name?
Yeah. Which, I mean, we spoke of this too, that it could seem as an insignificant question. But, you know, for him to finally get to that confession place to say what his name was meant more than just saying what his name was.
Exactly.
It was a confession of who he'd been since the womb, really. A deceiver, manipulator, you know, these terrible things that none of us want to identify with. God already knew that about him, but it takes us admitting it. You know, I think of parenting, and when I tell my child, like, you know, you're doing this, and this is the result of this, and I see this in you, and I want this to change. It's not until really often there's some pain attached to it that they can identify with it and admit it, right? It's not usually from someone else telling you. God could have said, you're a deceiver, you're a manipulator, you're this. He didn't. He asked him to bring it out himself.
And just another point with this is often we're very clear about the other person.
Yeah.
And I think Jesus said something really powerful in the Sermon on the Mount when he was dealing with this kind of thing. He said, you know, you guys are focused on the sliver in your neighbor's eye and you're missing the log in your own. Mm-hmm. And this was the day or the moment when Joseph said, I got a log.
Yeah.
There is a big log in my eye.
Yeah.
And that admission clears up your life. It clears up your path into humility.
Absolutely.
Into a humbleness with God.
Yeah.
You now cannot live in this pridefulness of comparison world or anything like that. You don't know what they did to me. It's your response.
Yes,
it's your response.
Absolutely.
So the log and the sliver really fit here.
Yeah, actually this morning in my devotions, I read this line that said, we judge others by their actions and we judge ourselves by our intentions, right?
And that's the log and the sliver.
It is, exactly. Yeah. So very, very true. And until you can come to that point where you see the log, it's like the real change can't happen.
Right.
You know, it just can't.
It can't. Mm-hmm. And so this admission, to come to that, to recognize the deep humility right now has been worked in this guy. Because you can't come to these points without deep humility.
Yeah.
And it's the pain and the wrestling and the years and everything that can bring you to those points of clarity.
Yeah.
And, but I'm telling you, they are the most freeing times.
Yes.
Because now we go into the last part. And the last part is really a cool part. He gets a new ID.
Yeah.
He gets a new name and a new start. Mm-hmm. And he's walking in a new power and a new strength.
That's right.
It comes to the point where, you know, God has now touched his hip.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I've seen God face to face. I'm alive. I didn't die.
Mm-hmm.
More or less, and I'm not hidden anymore from God. And he's not hidden anymore from me. But he left me with a limp. We think face to face sometimes is with God would mean, wow, you know, like I just move from strength to strength. Actually,
not
weakness.
Our own. Yeah, weakness is the opportunity for God to show off his strength. When we're moving in our own strength, we see all throughout this story and all throughout the Bible and hopefully in our own lives, where when we're moving in our own strength, it's not the way. It's not, we're moving basically from weakness to weakness.
And I remind us of the scripture we covered last night, which is found in 2 Corinthians 12:9. But Christ said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. This is in the context of him having a thorn in his flesh. He's saying there's something I've got every day I deal with.
Yes.
In Jacob's case, it was a limp.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
Paul, this massively, can we say, influential apostle, has got a thorn in his flesh. He said three times, he says, take it away from me. And this is the Lord's response. No. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. So he's saying, I'm keeping your weakness because that's my PowerPoint.
Yeah.
That's where it's going to really come to bear.
Right. And for us, I think that needs to reframe, A, how we look at our weaknesses as God's strength, and B, that we're never written off from God's dream being lived out in our lives. We have to be resilient. We have to get back up and keep moving forward, hopefully into a different place that's more towards God's will and his dream for our lives. But like, God is never going to write us off no matter what. This is a grace story. It's not our work. So if we've screwed up and we have a checkered past, God can use all that. That's our weakness that he can use to be more.
In fact, it may be your vault with the treasure behind.
That's exactly right.
And that's the stuff that grace makes possible.
Absolutely.
And so here's how it winds up. He meets Esau the next day.
Mm.
And they end up falling on each other's neck.
Yeah.
Crying. Mm-hmm. Esau sees him and runs to his brother.
Mm-hmm.
Arms, tears, wow.
Real reconciliation.
God did a work in both.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, look, you want more of God's power. You want to see more of God. Know that that means that you're going to have to live with God in your weakness. And he's more than willing to live with you in your weaknesses because of his grace.
Yeah.
It is a grace-based relationship. Don't turn it into law again. Grace brings you strength and power. That's how he brings it. And your weaknesses cause you to lean into grace. So lean into grace. God bless you.